Hey there, it's Dan Kenner with another episode of The Casual Author. Today is Monday, August 28th, 2023, as I record this, and this is episode number 87 of the podcast. Today we're talking to Dee Ray about her book of children's stories, Grandma's Children's Stories. It's an excellent conversation about inspiring children, about learning how to gear your writing with morals and lessons that are very important and key for younger audiences this day. I think you'll really enjoy that conversation. Dee has some amazing insight, and she's just a great grandma. I think you'll really enjoy hearing me talk to her. So it's been a while since I have posted a podcast. I'm sure you've gathered that. There was a piece of time in the past couple weeks where things just came to a head in terms of life. There's a lot of things going on with the homestead. There were a lot of things going on with my job. There was just so much that I figured, I don't think I'm going to be able to get podcast episodes out for the foreseeable future. Now, I would have loved to make an update episode explaining that, because I know some of you are probably thinking, where's Dan? He hasn't made an episode in a long time. But we're back. I'm back in the swing of things. I'm gathering those interviews again, so hopefully this will be more regular. As a reminder, I did reduce it to once every other week for now. Every 2 weeks, there'll be podcasts for The Casual Author until winter. Probably when winter comes, we'll be able to get back into the weekly schedule. Summer is just wild for the homestead. It's a good thing. There's so much to do, but it does prevent me from doing as many episodes as I would like to. So that's just the reality of being a casual author, and we're going to move forward with that. So on that front, what's been going on the homestead? Primarily, it is preparation for winter. I know some of you may be thinking, preparation for winter? It's only August. Well, things turn really quickly here in Idaho. So we only have 6 to 8 more weeks before or possibly less before it starts getting pretty cold here. And so we need to prepare the chickens. We need to figure out their chicken coop situation. We have twice the size of flock that we had before. So we need to increase the size of that chicken coop. We're building an outdoor run as well, so they have access to more sun, access to more land. Come spring, it'll be more relevant. In the winter, it'll probably mostly snowed over. I'll have to clear it out for them, but still, just more space for the chickens. So that's where we've been putting a lot of attention and focus. We've also been trying to get the goats sold, which we did sell some. If you're following my email updates, you will see that we sold a couple of the babies. We still have the 3 lingering. We'd love to find them new homes, but it's just proving more tricky than we expected. On top of that, it's mostly just reorganizing, winterizing things, preparing for that fall and winter. So there you go. That's what's been going on in the homestead. Our garden has been exploding. There are more meals often than not that are primarily garden foods, right? Except for we actually do grow the meat, right? If we have something with chicken and vegetables and even seasonings and herbs, we're getting those from our garden. It's incredible to be able to go outside and pick some parsley, some basil, some rosemary, those types of things, and we have it fresh for our food. We've got onions, garlic, all the seasoning. So it's really amazing to have these garden fresh meals straight from our garden. And that really comes to the reason of why we still do our homestead. Even though it is very busy with my full-time job and the kids and all the other things going on, homeschooling, it's still a big piece of our lives, and we don't want to give that up. So once again, that is partially why I am a casual author, and we're just plugging along, just doing the best that we can. In terms of my authoring, things have been moving at a steady pace. So the Cyber City, the Kids of Cyber City, the trilogy has been completely drafted. We wrote the final words of it last week, or I think it was about 2 weeks ago, actually. So we are now in the editing phase, which means I am in the editing phase of 4 books at once. You can imagine how not fun that is for me. Now, I'm a positive person, so I'm always going to come at editing with a very positive perspective, but I don't like editing. Editing is not the place I like to be. If I could just draft and draft and draft and hand off and be like, all right, just make this pretty and publish it, I totally would. But I'm a self-published author, and I don't have the means or the network to do that. So I'm in the editing phase. A lot of it is pumping myself up every morning, like, all right, we're editing again today, because I have 4 books to edit. We're hoping to get those out, the trilogy, the Cyber City trilogy, out by the end of the year. I would like to get Dragon Blooded out by the end of the year if I can. It is currently with a line editor and beta readers at the same time. The timing is a little bit unexpected, but I'm grateful for all the feedback I can get. That line editor is about to send that back to me this week. So I will probably cry. I see all of the comments, happy tears. We'll call them happy tears. No, not really. It's just part of the process of making it better. Looking forward to getting that back, hearing that feedback. The betas have been providing amazing feedback, so I'm very grateful for that. Now I'm currently shopping around for covers. Now I have a great cover artist. I love him and the work that he does. Just trying to negotiate prices, figure out what makes sense for this 6-book series. Given that I am a discovery writer, I'm confident that it will be 6 books. I mean, the Lightbearer Chronicles, I knew was going to be a trilogy when I wrote the first book, and it was. So I'm confident that my intuition will make it into a 6-book series. But admittedly, I don't know. It's all going to go. I know how the very, very end of the series is going to be. But that's pretty much it. Everything else in between, I don't know. We'll figure it out as we go. So Dragon Blooded will be out soon, hopefully. Hopefully you'll see that. So that's kind of fun in the authoring. The life of a discovery writer / discovery liver. Everything I do is very discovery-like. It's just an interesting way to live. But it works for me. My wife doesn't work for her as much. She's the planner. But we figure it out together. That's why we're perfect for each other. It works out great. Other than that, I don't think there's lots of updates. So, given the lack of additional updates, we can go ahead and shift over into the interview portion of the podcast with Dee. Hey, Dee, how are you today?
Great.
Excellent. I'm thrilled to have a conversation with you. I always love talking to children's stories authors, because as a child I loved to read stories myself, so I'm excited to dig into that.
Great.
So how long have you been writing and publishing?
Well, I think my first book I published about 12 years ago, but that was about investing.
Oh, okay. And so this book that you've written recently, it's called Grandma Children's Stories by Grandma Dee Dee, is that correct?
That is correct.
So what's the story behind Children's Stories by Grandma Dee Dee?
Well, I used to take care of my 5-year-old granddaughter a lot, and she liked stories and she liked bedtime stories. So I used to make up stories for her. And then as we kept doing this, I thought, well, maybe I'll start saving these. I'm going to publish them someday. So that's what I did. And they were usually bedtime stories, so not pictures, because we're just to make them up. But she had to use her imagination, because they were stories that were, you know, telling at bedtime with no books.
Yeah, absolutely. That's awesome. So when did you decide that you wanted to publish? Because, you know, parents and grandparents, they tell their children and grandchildren stories all the time. I'm curious to know, what was the turning point for you where you said, actually, I want to publish these stories?
Actually, it just clicked in my mind one day. Maybe you should save these. You might want to publish them because they have lessons in them. And I think it's hard for children sometimes. You know, they need some kind of guidance, and they need to be trained in kindness and gratitude. And, you know, and then there's also some on it using their imagination. So just, you know, some things about how my family grew up and when she was little and all that kind of thing. A large variety of stories.
Well, I think, like you said, stories connect with children so well when it comes to teaching these principles. So I've done a similar thing with my children, except mine have a theme. So I used to call them Steven stories, because the main character was always Steven, and then he had a couple of side characters, and it was very fantastical, but they learned these morals and lessons within them. So are Grandma Dee Dee's stories, are they all kind of theme based? Is it around the same type of characters, or is it just kind of a random hodgepodge of great stories?
It's just variety. Some are teaching them to use their imagination. Some are teaching them how to be kind to other kids and things like that. Never to tease, you know, somebody handicapped and things like that, you know. Just some basic moral lessons. And basically they teach kindness. Like somebody that was reading them said, there's always a lesson in there somewhere.
Well, I mean, that's exactly the great thing about storytelling, is that you can kind of use whatever imaginative style you want to portray these lessons, which are so vital to kids. They're in their malleable age where their brains are just developing and they're learning so much.
Exactly.
And I think that's amazing. So just out of curiosity, because like me, I don't know if you're like me, where my children ask me to tell a story story, and I would just come up with it on the spot. You know, I had the main characters, and I would just be like, all right, let's just make it up as I go. For these stories, were these stories that you just made up on the go, on the fly, or did you think ahead of time prior to putting your kids or grandchildren to bed to tell the stories?
Well, mostly just on the fly, you know, just instantaneously.
It's so fun, though. Oh. Isn't that so fun?
Yeah, it is fun, yeah. But and they usually love them. You know, it helps them go to rest and go to sleep and, you know, things like that.
And then they're requesting more the next night. They're like, oh, that was so exciting. I want more, which is great. It means you're a good storyteller.
Right. Yeah, they love that, yeah.
So how did you go about documenting these stories? Did you just pull them from your memory, you know, kind of bullet point list and wrote them as you went? How did you remember all of these stories?
Well, what I did, I started putting them on a tape recorder so I could remember them. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Nice. See, this is the thing I always forget about tape recorders. It must be something about my generation, the technical age, how simple voice recording devices can change your life. When remembering past information, for me, I just always forget to turn them on.
Right. Yeah, I know what you mean.
But
every generation is a little bit different.
Yep. Well, I mean, we all have our strengths and our weaknesses, and we're learning from each other, which is excellent. So with the stories that you've published, do you intend to continue publishing more books like this, or are you just going to see how this one does before you keep publishing more?
Well, I've published 3 books, but they're all different.
Okay. Okay, let's talk about that.
The one in children's stories, one in How to Treat a Lady, and the other one's called Women, Money, and Emotions.
Okay.
So they're all very different from different walks of life.
Yeah, very different. So we've talked a little bit about Grandma Dee Dee's, but where did your motivation come for these other books that you've written?
Well, on the Women, Money, Emotions, I realized that women didn't know a lot about investing, so I just wanted to make it simple so they could learn how to invest and not depend on their husband or someone else, because a lot of times they're left a widow or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in the financial business as a financial advisor, so I decided to write it just as a helpful thing for women. And then the other one, because I was single for so long, How to Treat a Lady, I realized that men needed somewhat of an education of how you wanted to be treated. And my husband said, yeah, I think they need education, you know. So I always got a kick out of that. So then when he died, I was out on the dating scene again. And so I realized, wow, there's a lot to learn. And some of my women clients read it too, and they said it was helpful to them also.
Yeah, I mean, that is exactly the type of talk. There's a lot of practical things in life that I feel like you don't always learn in schools.
And, exactly.
You know, these are the types of topics that this isn't a knock on schools or anything. Obviously, the schooling system that we have is what it is, and they're hitting certain points and missing some other points. But things like values and things like investing, like you indicated, it's not as prevalent in school curriculum. And so, you know, it's kind of left up to authors like us, children's books authors and other authors, to share their knowledge. So where did you gain this knowledge? Is this something you learned from schooling or something you learned from just experience?
Well, I learned it mostly all from experience because, like I said, I was an investment advisor with over 400 clients. And then the children's stories, everybody's a child, so you remember some of your lessons. And then the How to Treat a Lady just came from practical experience.
I mean, that's exactly the type of thing that readers can benefit from is you sharing that experience. And that's right. You had mentioned that you were an advisor. I think that's awesome. So you have a passion for it already. Taking your passions and putting it into writing is challenging, though. Being able to put it into writing. It is an interesting process, isn't it? So what did that process look like for you of taking these things and putting it into writing?
Well, I never really had much problem with it. You know, in Women, Money, and Emotions, you have to look up a lot of data, you know, present facts and stuff. So that's a little bit more difficult because you have to do a lot of research and put it in English so they can understand it. You can't talk technical terms. You have to call realistic things so they know what you're talking about. So, yeah, and that's kind of, the investment world is kind of fun because you have to keep up to date and you get to talk to wonderful people from all walks of life. So it's quite exciting.
That is really fun. It provides a great opportunity to come to an understanding of the needs of your reader and put that into, like I said, putting into words is tricky, not only from the technical perspective, but also the almost maybe not summarizing, but condensing perspective. If you could write every little piece and bits of knowledge that you had, I imagine that book would probably be kind of lengthy.
Well, it is pretty lengthy.
Is it pretty
actually.
Lengthy? How long is it?
Oh, I don't know the exact number of pages, but
long.
It's pretty long. I'm sure it has charts and examples and all that stuff.
Thick enough to prove a threat to someone if you were to whack them with it, right?
Well, yeah, maybe.
Not that we want to do that, but that gives you a little bit of a basis of the thickness of the book. But I mean, it's fun, you know, being an author. This is something that when I started writing myself, I did not expect to fall so deeply into it, meaning just fall in love with the process, because I was always something that I was a little bit afraid to get into is, oh, I don't know how to write a book, or maybe I'm not eloquent enough. But I found that as I dove into the process, it was so enjoyable. Did you feel that for your books as well?
Well, I thought the basic thing was to be honest and upright and kind of write the story from the heart.
Yeah.
I always believe in writing from the heart and being sincere.
And I think that's lost sometimes with authors, and readers can detect that. Now, maybe some readers don't care, but I feel like when I'm reading a book, if I can tell I'm reading a book from the author's heart, I find it so much more enjoyable.
Yeah, I agree.
So do you read a lot of the same type of books that you've written as well, or are you not much of a reader yourself?
Well, my job required a lot of reading because you have to find out and keep track of what's going on in the world. So there's many newsletters and many articles and things you have to read constantly. Yeah. So it's a lot of reading.
Well, but the learning piece is really important. I think there's a lot of authors that forget that. You should be constantly learning. That's the best way that you can help other people learn as well, is if you're learning.
Exactly. I agree with that.
So that kind of flipping back to the children's book example for children's stories by Grandma Dee Dee. Do you read a lot of children's books to your kids as well? Formalized published children's books and grandkids?
Well, I used to read a lot. My dad used to read to us a lot. And so I got kind of in the habit of that because we just loved to have him read to us. My son was more of a tomboy, so I can't remember that I read so much to him, but I did read a lot to my granddaughter, yeah. But it's just kind of fun to see them get excited and use their imagination. And I know this one client of mine, she says she bought the book, and I think her grandchild was only like 3 or 4, so she lets him pick out the story, and then she reads it, and he says they just kind of do it together, and she said they have a lot of fun.
Yeah, and that's really the element of it, is to have fun and to spur imagination. I think it's kind of sad how much imagination is left out of a child's development these days. Feels like it's stunted by some bits of technology can aid it to some degree, but I think it can be lost. It kind of deters a child's ability to imagine new ideas and new things. And I think books really open up that imagination.
Right. You encourage the children to be children and to have fun along the way.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we're all boring adults now, so we don't know how to have fun, right?
Yeah. I think children know more how to have fun, but you also got to realize that they run across a lot of obstacles. Like some kids just aren't nice. And, you know, I remember my mother had us have so much manners, no, sir, yes, sir, excuse me. And the first time I went to first grade, I thought, my, these kids are kind of rude. And then I noticed some other kids being rude to other people. And I thought, well, that's not right, you know. So a lot of my stories are around that. Being kind. Just be kind, you know. Be nice.
Well, and we have stories have the advantage of taking characters that your child can relate with and putting them in situations that maybe your child hasn't been in or maybe never will be in, however fantastical or dangerous they are. So the children's stories I came up with were they were pretty wild, right? Taking this kid found a magic box and went to a fantasy world with fantasy creatures. It was, out there. But those types of situations, you can use them to help children today be prepared for situations that are similar. Maybe not exactly the same, but like you said, how did you know when you went to first grade that those people were being mean, right? I mean, you
Right.
learned that somewhere. You hadn't been in that situation yet.
Right. Yeah. And some of them do develop imagination. Like some of them are about Christmas stories where potatoes start to dance and the bells all ringing on the Christmas tree and stuff like that. And other ones are about how she found out what was special about this one little boy. And she said some of the little kids had been mean to this bird and killed it. So she said, "I want to see what's so special about this boy." So she followed him, and she said he found a little bird and he nursed it to health. And so she thought the little boy who was handicapped was a very positive example for other children.
Yeah, that is an excellent example. And like you said, a situation that they may have not been in yet, but they might come across at some point.
Yeah, kids come across more than you think,
Yeah, that's true.
Especially nowadays with the internet, they get harassed quite a bit.
Yes, and each child's circumstance is quite different. But yes, I think a lot of parents may underestimate or under realize the reality of this world. It is definitely very different than when we were children.
That's for sure.
That's which, once again, not necessarily a bad thing, just very different. So something we have to account for as parents and grandparents.
That's right.
So I guess for you, when you were crafting this children's story, how do you know what makes a good children's book? What advice do you have for someone who would like to write a children's storybook?
Well, it's good to put some real life experiences in there, and it's good to put some in where they can use their imagination and just fantasize and have fun. And things like that. And the other ones are just to teach them kindness. So when they get out in the world, they kind of know what to expect. So just everyday lessons, I guess you would say.
Yeah, absolutely. It doesn't have to be overly complicated. That's don't overthink it, because these everyday life experiences, like you said, are often the most important, because that's what they're experiencing so often.
Right, I agree with you.
So, what's in store for Grandma Dee Dee's children's stories? Do you anticipate that? Are you hoping to reach more children visiting schools, or how are you getting out there and finding your audience for this book?
Well, so far I've had it's on the internet under Dee Ray, some of them under the internet. And you can also get them on Amazon, and you can also get them on Library Time. You can also get them on Goodreads. I know what you're saying, that promotion is important, but I guess I'm not an expert on promoting, but learning as I go along the way.
Well, neither am I, so don't worry. That's the point of learning. So the great thing about being an self is this a self-published book, or did you publish through a publishing company?
No, it's self-published, yeah.
Awesome. Wonderful. I mean, obviously the author is at liberty to market and find their audience themselves, regardless of their traditional or self-published. But definitely self-published books have a little bit more of a learning curve, a steep
Yeah, a little bit
learning
more
curve.
challenges. A
Yes.
little bit more challenges, yeah.
So I've heard from other children's books authors that they really like to visit elementary school classes and or assemblies or whatever to share their book. Is that something that you've ever considered for your books?
No, I haven't really ever thought about that. Sometimes in the local libraries here, they want people to come up and read to the children, once a week or something like that. So I thought about that, but I really haven't followed through on it. So you actually read the actual kids then. So I imagine that would be kind of fun.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, no rush. The great thing about publishing is your book will be there forever, right?
Right.
It's not going anywhere, so you've got some time. But I've heard some various things about people visiting elementary schools and just having a blast with it. I also have never done that, but then again, I don't write children's books, so the closest thing to a children's book that I've written is a middle grade series, so kind of for like children 8 to 12, kind of that age
Oh,
group.
I see.
So
I see. Yeah.
not
These
quite
are for
so.
like, these are written in for more 5-year-olds in that age group. But 5-year-olds are so cute and they still like you at that age.
Well, that's true. And that's after the terrible twos and teenager age. I have 6 kids, so I love the children at all their ages and they have their challenges. But I hear what you say, when they hit 5, they become sweet all of a sudden for the most part. And it's
Right.
just,
Well, I grew up with 5 sisters and 2 brothers. So,
oh, so you know.
yeah, I know. Yep.
You remember the what I like to call is the beautiful chaos of life. No, it's so much fun. This is a completely random question, only because I'm genuinely curious, and we are doing this without video. But is the picture of Grandma Dee Dee on the cover, does that look like you?
Yeah, it kind of does. Yeah.
Kind of. When you were working with your cover artist, did you send a picture of yourself in a rocking chair and said, "Do this"?
No, I just sent the description and it came up with it.
Okay, I love it. I think it's awesome. I was just curious to know if it was like an illustrated version of a real life picture or not, but that's fun. Do you have a favorite story from this book that you love?
I like the one about the little boy saving the bird, and I like the one about the Christmas holidays when they woke up and saw all this stuff going on in the kitchen, you know. The bells ringing and the potatoes jumping out of the pan and dancing and pretty imaginary.
But it's
So.
fun. That's exactly the magic of Christmas. Kids love Christmas. I loved Christmas as a kid.
And then I wrote one about Halloween, and the kids were going to go up and terrorize this woman. And then when they got up, they found out they really liked her and had a lot of fun, and they became good friends.
Oh, that's awesome. Once again, very
Yeah.
fun, realistic. I guess, how do I say this? The kids love things like Halloween and Christmas, and what a better way to bring something into what they love than morals and lessons and stories that teach them things. I think that's a really good tactic to use holidays. I had never thought of that before.
Yeah, and then I wrote one about a little boy from a different country with a different language, and they met him and they really learned to love him too and accept him in their as their friends. So I thought that was important too, that they are kind to people that are coming from someplace else or from a different background.
Yeah, I'm once again, particularly in our current age, an extremely important message to teach children because there are a lot of negative narratives around that subject. And so,
That's right.
storybook ideas like this are so instrumental in helping children have a more realistic and positive view about things.
Well, like the one gentleman that read my book, he said there's always a lesson in there somewhere. And the main lesson I want to get across is be kind, and then the other ones are for your imagination and having fun.
I think so we homeschool. The reason that's relevant is because we are constantly seeking books like yours that help teach an important message or history or something to that degree. And there's a very clear way to tell if something is full of messages and worthwhile, or what I've heard, I can't remember where I've heard this term used before, but they called it twaddle. That's essentially books that have no morals, they have no message in them. They're still children's books, so maybe they're kind of fun, but there's nothing really, there's no really good point to them. So,
Oh, I see.
preference wise, I prefer the non-twaddle books like yours, where there's a very poignant and clear message to be learned from it, even if it's an imaginative lesson. I mean, that is definitely something to learn from it. If there's a clear point to it, then I think it's way more effective as a children's book.
Yeah, I think it's kind of fun to do that too. It's fun to write them and see the kids get excited.
It is really fun, absolutely, and it kind of fuels this fire in you to write more.
Right, I think you're correct on that one.
keep you motivated. Not that we need motivation because we're having fun with what we're doing, but
exactly.
So this is just also a little bit of an interesting question. When you go about writing your book, do you find yourself outlining the stories completely before you go into writing, or do you just kind of discover it as you go?
No, I don't usually use the outline. I usually just comes natural.
Mm-hmm. It sounds, yeah.
I think I have an overdeveloped imagination myself, so it's easy.
But that's a good thing. You know, I used to think for a long time that it was weird, but it's not. It's a very good thing, even for an adult, to have an overactive imagination.
I think you're correct, yes.
Some people
more
just
fun like, than.
Yeah, and it's fun.
Right.
Who said we can't have fun, right?
Yeah, who wants to be bored, right?
This is very true. Hey, I don't know. Some people, I'm convinced, like to be bored.
Oh, that could be.
It's just like, you know, I always find it fascinating, which, once again, I understand people's, I guess, habits and interests and whatnot. When I talk to someone, they say, oh, I don't really like reading. I'm like, oh, that's just so strange to me. I can understand. It's once again, not a problem if you don't like reading. There's plenty of other things to fill your time with. But I've always had a love for reading that, to me, is just so strange that someone can't appreciate even reading a little bit. It's just so interesting.
I think it's important for people to read, yes, starting from the time they're little, you know, to being adults. Mm-hmm. I think reading is very important, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, even for anything to succeed in schooling, because you do need to read for
that's right,
whether boring and interesting reads, right? It's just a reality. Reading is there. But yeah, I've been so pleased to see. So far, five out of my six, the sixth one is only 7 months old, so she's not really into that reading phase, but the other five we'll just find them quietly sitting in a row on the couch, just reading their books. It's just like,
oh, that's nice.
They're great moments. You love it. So how many grandchildren do you have?
I just have one.
Awesome.
And I used to spend a lot of weekends with her. So I used to take care of her a lot on weekends. So I had plenty of time to make up stories for her.
And this
and
is
now she has her own children, and her mother reads my books, my stories to them.
Wow. That so is what
passing what down, kind of, yeah.
That's so cool.
Yeah, it's fun.
It must make you proud to have that family see your the work you've done.
Yeah, I like it. It's interesting, sure.
As a parent and grandparent.
Here's your pleasure. Right.
And a great
Here's
grandparent,
your
correct? You have
yeah.
That's how wonderful.
Time passes.
That's the scary thing. I feel like every day I'm thinking, it's already August 25th, right? You know, whatever day. When did that happen? Where is this year going?
Yeah, exactly.
But just take the moments to appreciate.
Yeah, I can't.
What you got?
Can't believe it. Labor Day is almost here.
I don't know where this year went. It seriously came out from under my feet. And the kids are growing so fast, I can't believe it. They're like weeds.
Yeah, that's right. Well, you got your hands full with six of them, that's for sure.
Well,
but
yeah.
sometimes the more kids you have, the better mannered they are, the better discipline they are, the more mature they are.
Sometimes. No, my kids are great. We have very wonderful children. And I think, you know, I grew up with four siblings. And I grew up reading. Everyone in my family grew up reading. We just read all the time and talked about books and whatnot. So when my wife and I were deciding about children, she only had a couple siblings and they were quite younger than her. And so she felt a little bit like an only child, even though she wasn't, right? Because she had little sisters. The gap was big enough that she didn't grow up with other children. So we wanted to give our kids that opportunity. That's why we have six.
Yeah, well, good for you.
And they're having a blast. They love it.
Oh, that's good.
So I always love to ask, you talked a little bit about where your book is on Amazon. Sounds like you can get it in some libraries. Is that correct?
Right.
Where else can people find more information about you and your books?
Well, I have a website under Dee Ray, and it's on Library Time, and it's on Goodreads, and it's on Amazon. So there's plenty of places to look for it.
Excellent. Very good. Well, I appreciate you joining me today. This has been an excellent conversation.
Well, thank you. It's been fun.
I hope you found that as fun as I did. Talking to Dee felt like a breath of fresh air. Someone who's just very genuine and very interested in just writing fun and impactful stories for younger people, younger children. I love telling my own children's stories, and I think this is the type of book for parents who are just looking for good, fun, teachable things for their kids. Grab this book. I think you'll really enjoy that. So next, in 2 weeks, we'll be talking to E.A. Winters about her step-by-step approach to success. It is an incredible conversation. She's a very charismatic and very friendly person and very frank. You know, you hear a lot of great things in that interview about the realities and the challenges of being an author, but the things that she's learned, and she's reached a point where she's paying herself. She is a successful author, and that is the place where we all want to be with our self-publishing. So I'm not there yet. I will get there someday. I'm confident I will. Just it's going to take a little bit longer by nature of my casual perspective of the authoring. So I think you'll really like that conversation. You'll tune into that. And once again, that's 2 weeks from today. So thanks for listening. And if you are interested in being on the podcast, or you know authors or cover designers, anybody else who's trying to get out there, just have a friendly conversation and, you know, be on a podcast, direct them to me. You can send me an email at authordkenner@gmail.com and or dankenner.com/podcast. You can send them there. There's a submission form. Would love to have anybody talk to anybody about your experience, whether you're new or successful or traditionally self-published. It doesn't matter. We're here just to be enlightened and have a good time, talk about the positive and sometimes negative aspects of publishing. So tune in next time in 2 weeks, and I think we'll have a great time. Thanks so much. Thank you.